So in the last two lectures, we have discussed about the device physics of the MOSFET, and we have also derived the current voltage characteristics. And in this particular unit, I'll be talking about the MOS amplifier. Now, before I start, let me once again write down the expression, because this expression will be extremely useful for you to understand the MOSFET as an important component of an amplifier. So as you understand, the drain current of the MOSFET, so let me consider the NMOS for example. So the expression for drain current is given by mu n C aux into W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square with a half outside. So let me just erase that part. Yeah. And this expression is valid in the saturation region without considering the effect of channel length modulation. And if I consider the expression of current in the linear region, then it is given by mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH into VDS minus half VDS square. And this is true in the linear region or triad region. Now, as you can see, in linear region, the drain current of the MOSFET depends upon the gate to source voltage as well as on the drain to source voltage. Therefore, the three terminals of the device, gate, drain, and source, they have some say in controlling the drain current. And that is the scenario in linear region or triad region. And we have also established the condition for deep triad region where this value is much, much greater as compared to the second value. That means the deep triad region is identified by VGS minus VTH, rather 2 into VGS minus VTH is much, much greater than VDS. And this region is known as deep triad region. In which case, you will find that the drain current, this ID, is linearly proportional with the drain to source voltage. Therefore, in deep triad region, we can always model the MOS device as a resistance, where this half VDS squared, that term is considered to be almost negligible. That means it is tending towards zero. That means when the drain to source voltage is much, much small as compared to the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage, which is known as the overdrive voltage, VGS minus VTH. However, in saturation region, you will find that the drain current essentially depends upon the gate to source voltage. So if I just forget about the effect of the channel length modulation, so then the gate to source voltage will determine the drain current under the saturation region. However, if I consider the channel length modulation, then obviously, last year we have derived the expression. So it is given by W by L, VGS minus VTH whole squared. And then we have the dependence on VDS. And accordingly, this 1 plus lambda VDS term is added. And this is the expression for drain current in saturation region. Saturation region with channel length modulation. And we have also seen that the transconductance, that is GM, of this MOSFET is heavily dependent upon the corresponding value of the gate to source voltage. In fact, we have already derived the expression for GM And the expression for GM was something like mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH. So that can be easily computed by taking this delta ID by delta VGS, by differentiating this ID with respect to VGS. That is nothing but the mutual conductance or transconductance. So this expression is nothing but delta ID upon delta VGS. And this will give you mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH. That means the transconductance is a function of the gate to source voltage. So if I consider that the device dimension is fixed, that means W by L is fixed, and the CMOS technology is constant, that means C ox is constant. So under this condition, this GM or the mutual conductance depends upon the gate to source voltage. However, this expression is valid only in the saturation region. And last year, we have also derived that if I consider the value of GM under linear region, then you'll see that the value of GM drops significantly in linear region, where VGS value is very small. And that can also be apparently seen from the expression. That means if GM, if the VGS value is very small, then the GM value approaches towards zero. So our objective here, to use the MOS device as an amplifier. And as you know, this MOS device is acting as a voltage controlled current source. So therefore, depending upon the value of the gate to source voltage, the corresponding drain current will be modulated. And ultimately, whenever the drain current passes through a resistance, then the voltage will be developed. So for a fixed value of the resistance, drain resistance here, for a fixed value of the drain resistance, here our idea is to maximize the value of the output voltage. So to do that, we have to operate the MOS device in any particular region where GM is maximum or the mutual conductance is maximum. So that is possible in the saturation region where GM is maximum. And we have also derived the expression for that the last day. So therefore, whenever we are going to use the MOS device as an amplifier, so unlike BJT here, I'll be using or I'll be operating the MOS device in saturation region. So let us start with a simpler, or rather the simplest MOS amplifier. So let me first draw the device. So I'm considering NMOS. So we have drain, gate, and source. So these are the three terminals. So this is the gate terminal. This is the drain terminal, and we have the source terminal. Now suppose this source is grounded. And we have a supply over here. And suppose there is a resistance, RD. And this is VDD. So we are taking the output from this terminal, V out. And V in is applied between the gate and source. In fact, this particular configuration is a common source kind of configuration. So while you have studied the BJT amplifier, you have seen that there are three different configuration for the BJT amplifier. We have a common emitter configuration, we have common base configuration, and we have common collector configuration. And accordingly, each and every configuration is having their own advantages and disadvantages. Similarly, here in MOS amplifier, let us start our discussion with a common source kind of topology. And while considering the amplifier, as you understand, so there are different parameters associated with the amplifier. So for a quick recapitulation, let me just remind you the different parameters which are extremely useful in choosing any particular amplifier topology. So one is the gain of the amplifier. That is very important. So we always want that the gain of any amplifier should be as high as possible, and it should be a constant parameter. That means gain remains constant with respect to certain fluctuation. Then obviously the input and the output impedance. Input and the output impedance. That is also important. Then you have the different time constant. So in the circuit, whenever we will be analyzing the performance, the transient analysis, whenever we will be performing the transient analysis, then the corresponding performance of the device very much depends upon the corresponding RC time constant, and therefore a bandwidth plays a very vital role in selecting any particular amplifier topology, and obviously the power consumption. So this is also important. We would always want that the power consumption resulting from an amplifier circuit should be as minimum as possible. And another important thing, that is the voltage swing. So we should expect that the voltage swing should be as high as possible. So these are the different parameters pertaining to any amplifier design, let it be a BJT based amplifier or MOS based amplifier. So gain, so we always want that the gain value should be as high as possible, and it should be a linear function. I mean, it should be constant. It's not that for a particular value of the input voltage gain is 50, and if I just change the input voltage, the gain becomes say 70. So in that case, you'll find that the gain is not linear. So we always expect that the gain should be linear. And from your knowledge in digital signal processing, perhaps you understand what is the meaning, what is the notion of linearity. If I have two different inputs, suppose if I have a 10 millivolt signal, the output is say, for a 10 millivolt signal, the output is say 100, say for 10 millivolt signal, output say 1000 millivolt. And for a 50 millivolt signal, suppose the output is like 5000. Millivolt. Now, since it's linear, so you can clearly understand for an input of 60 millivolt, the output is nothing but the summation of these two, that is 6000 millivolt. Now, that is only true whenever the gain is constant. So here you find that the gain is always 100. Now, consider a situation where the gain is also a function of the input signal. That means when the input signal is small, the gain is equal to 100. And when the input signal is large, the gain becomes say 150 or 120. So in that case, for 50 millivolt, you won't be getting 5000 millivolt. Rather, you might be getting like 6000 millivolt. So 10 plus 50 millivolt, whenever you are applying 60 millivolt input signal, the output signal is not the simple linear combination. So we always want that the linearity property must hold good. That means our objective here is to design a linear amplifier, as well as to increase the gain of the amplifier. And input and output impedance, you understand what is the importance of input and output impedance. We always want that for a voltage amplifier, the input impedance should be as large as possible and output impedance should be as small as possible. And here, since between, if I consider a common source kind of topology, let me write it down over here. Common source, as we have used in this particular diagram, common source amplifier, or CS. So here the input is applied between gate to source, and the output is obtained between drain to source. So what happens, as you understand, that there is an insulator, a silicon dioxide layer between the gate and the channel. So obviously the input impedance is very large for this type of amplifier. And we have to calculate what is the corresponding output impedance. And bandwidth depends upon the different capacitors which are present implicitly while you have designed a MOS device like this. Apart from that, we have to calculate the power consumption, we have to minimize the power consumption, and the voltage swing, we always want to improve the voltage swing. So these are the different parameters. So to start with, let me just once again, I think, no, it is not possible to copy it. So let me once again draw. And let us check what happens whenever the input signal starts from zero. So this is the simplest diagram, simplest architecture. Here we have not considered any second order effect. So let us assume that the channel in modulation right now, it is not present. And say the body effect we have not also considered. This one is RD. So V out. And this one is V in. Applied between this terminal and the ground terminal. Now initially, let me just draw the corresponding transfer characteristics. As you understand, these transfer characteristics will give you the information regarding the variation of the output voltage with respect to the input. So suppose this is the input voltage, and we would like to variation of the output with regard to the input voltage. Now what happens initially when the input voltage is less than the threshold voltage? So here in case of MOSFET, we have the concept of a threshold voltage. So as long as the input voltage is less than the threshold voltage of the MOS device, then the device is not on. And as long as the device is off, so you understand that there will be no current flowing through RD and the output voltage is equal to the supply voltage, that is VDD. So if the input voltage is pretty small, less than the threshold, then what happens? The output voltage is equal to the supply voltage, that is VDD. So until this point, the input voltage, if it is less than some threshold voltage, VTH, let it be VTH, the threshold voltage, until this point, the output voltage is constant, that is VDD. Then what happens? Now suppose the input voltage just crosses the threshold voltage, then what happens? You have to identify in which region the device is operating right now. Now you have to find out the corresponding value of the drain to source voltage, gate to source voltage, and accordingly you can say whether the device is operating in the saturation region or the device is operating in the linear region. Now the condition is that if the VDS value, the drain to source voltage, if that value is greater than the gate to source minus threshold voltage, VGS minus VTH, then we say that the device operates in the saturation region. So under this condition, or sometimes it is also equal, so the device operates in saturation region, and we will be trying to operate the device in the saturation region so as to maximize the gain. Now let us check what happens when the device just becomes on with a Vin value or gate to source voltage higher than the threshold voltage. Now if I assume that the supply VDD is large enough, it's not very small, it's large enough, then what about the drain to source voltage? Initially it was like VDD, the drain voltage was VDD just before the threshold voltage, just before the device becomes on, it was like VDD, and the source is grounded, so VDS is nothing but VDD. And what about the gate to source minus threshold voltage? That is very small. So whenever the device becomes on, so it becomes on in the saturation region, because now the VDS value is larger as compared to the VGS minus VTH. So device becomes on in saturation region. Now under saturation region, you can easily find out the expression for the output voltage. So output voltage expression V out can be simply written like VDD minus ID into RD, as simple as that. The output voltage V out can be represented by VDD, the supply, minus ID into RD. Now the expression for ID has to be put over here for saturation region. Now expression for ID is given by half mu n Cox W by L. I'm not considering the expression for channel length modulation. So VGS minus VTH. So instead of writing VGS, what I can do is I can simply write Vin, because VGS equal to Vin. The gate to source voltage is nothing but the input voltage. So Vin minus VTH whole square into RT. So that is the expression for the output voltage, VDD minus ID into RD. So ID expression for ID is given by half mu n Cox W by L, Vin minus VTH whole square into RT. Now as you can find over here, the variation as input voltage increases from VTH value, the corresponding output voltage drops down, and the corresponding reduction occurs quadratically, because we have a square term over here. So you can think that so as Vin increases, the corresponding V out value, so let me draw it once again, that part. So as Vin increases beyond VTH, the V out will drop like this. Then what happens? As you are moving beyond VTH, the corresponding gate to source voltage is going to increase. VGS value is going to increase, because VGS is nothing but Vin, you are increasing Vin. However, the output voltage, that is the drain to source voltage, is reducing. So the device will become on in saturation region as long as VDS value is greater than or equal to VGS minus VTH. Now a point will come whenever the device enters into the linear region or triad region, when VDS will become VGS minus VTH. Now, when the value is equal to the drain to source voltage equal to VGS minus VTH, then it is the beginning of the triad region, and whenever the input voltage is further increased, then gate to source minus threshold voltage will exceed the drain to source voltage, and ultimately the device enters into the triode region or linear region. So let us consider that this is the point. Suppose this is the point, and at this particular point, let this voltage equal to, say, let it be V dashed. So at this particular point, the device enters into the linear region. So what we can find at this particular point, the input voltage is, say, V dashed, or let it be, say, V in dashed. Then the input voltage will exceed the drain to source voltage by a threshold voltage. So at this particular point, V in dashed minus VTH is equal to V out dashed. So the corresponding output voltage, if I mark it over here, that is given by V out dashed. And if the V in value is increased further, then what happens? The gate to source minus threshold voltage will be exceeding the drain to source voltage, because as you increase V in further, the gate to source voltage is increasing, threshold voltage is constant, and drain to source voltage and the output voltage drops down. So obviously the device enters into the triad region, and if you increase it further, then ultimately the device enters into the deep triad region. So here, under this condition, whenever the device enters into the triad region, so at this particular point, one can easily write down the expression for the output voltage. So here, what we find is, I think it will be better if I write over here. So here, this V out, that is equal to VDS, and which is equal to V in dash minus VTH. So here you will find that V in dash minus VTH is equal to VDD minus half mu n Cox W by L into V in dashed minus VTH whole square into RD. And from this expression, you can easily find out the expression for V in dashed. And from V in dashed, you can easily find out the expression for the output voltage, because output voltage V out dashed is given by V in dashed minus VTH. So this expression is at the end of saturation region. At the end of saturation region.
Sir.
Any doubt?
Yes, sir. Sir, in triad region, why V or dash is equal to V in dash minus VTH?
Okay, that is okay. Let me explain. That is the beginning of the triad region. In fact, that is the beginning of the triad region. So, whenever you are increasing the input voltage from this point, say VTH onwards, so the device enters into the saturation region. That is quite obvious, because the drain to source voltage is greater than the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage. Therefore, the device enters into the saturation region. Now, as you move further within the saturation region, you will find that the input voltage is increasing and the output voltage is reducing. So input voltage increasing means what? The gate to source voltage increases and the drain to source voltage drops. Now a point will come when the value of the drain to source voltage is equal to the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage. And this point is known as the pinch off point. VDS, when you find that VDS equal to VGS minus VTH. So this is known as the pinch off point, and that point occurs here. That is a pinch off point. One can say that is a pinch off point or we can say that beginning of linear region. Beginning of linear region. So at this particular point, you can consider, you can easily find out the expression for the output voltage by following the same expression, just by putting the value V out is equal to V in dashed minus VTH. Because at this particular point, the drain to source voltage equal to gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage. What is the gate to source voltage? Nothing but the V in. So I'm calling this V in as V in dashed. That's why drain to source voltage at this point. So let this point be named like, say, let it be point P. So at point P, the drain to source voltage is given by V out dashed, and which is equal to the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage. So what is the gate to source voltage? V in dashed minus threshold voltage. So V out is equal to VDS equal to V in dashed minus VTH. So this drain to source voltage or V out is equal to VDD. So let me mark it. So this is VDS or V out, and at point P, this V out is given by VGS minus VTH. So that's why V in dash minus VTH, that is equal to VDD minus half mu and C aux WL into V in minus VTH whole square. So what is that V in? That V in is nothing but V in dash. So V in dash minus VTH whole square multiplied with RT. Now if you go further to the right of the point P, if you go further, then the device enters into the triode region or linear region. And then we can write the expression like, so I think it will be better if I once again draw the circuit. So this is your VDD. This is RD, and we're taking the output from this terminal, V out. Now when VDS is less than VGS minus VTH, that means the device enters into the linear region. And that occurs at the right of point P. At the right of point P, the VDS value is less than VGS minus VTH. At point P, VDS is exactly equal to VGS minus VTH. So right at point P, the VDS is less than VGS minus VTH. So then once again, the V out expression can be written like, V out can be written like VDD minus IDRT. So that is true always, IDRT, but the expression of ID will be different. So I can write here VDD minus, so expression for ID can be written like mu n C aux W by L. We have VGS minus VTH, so V in minus VTH into V out, that is VDS, minus half, I think, to look better if I draw on this side. No. Anyway. So the same expression will be there, VDD minus IDRT. So it follows the KVL, VDD minus IDRT. So, but the expression of ID will be different. So that is equal to VDD minus, you have mu n C aux W by L. And then we have VGS minus VTH. So VGS here is V in minus VTH into V out, minus half V out square multiplied with RT. And accordingly, you will find that the corresponding value of V out drops at a faster rate, and ultimately it looks something like that. So here our objective is to operate the device in the saturation region where the GM value is pretty large as compared to the linear region. And in the saturation region, already we have got the expression for V out. And the expression is given by this one, VDD minus half mu n cox W by L into V in minus VTH host gain to RT. So governed by this equation, we can easily find out the expression for gain. So once again, let me write down the expression for, the voltage expression. So V out in saturation region is given by VDD minus half mu n cox W by L into V in minus VTH whole square into RT. Now, in order to find out the gain, so as you know, the expression for the voltage gain is nothing but the variation of V out with respect to the variation of V in. So I have to differentiate it, and that differentiation will give me, so this is constant supply voltage, so it will be zero, and then you have a minus sign over here, then you have half mu n cox W by L into V in minus VTH whole square. So half and two will be canceled each other, and we have mu n cox W by L, and then you have V in minus VTH and then we have RT. Now already you have come across this term mu n cox W by L V in minus VTH. So this is nothing but the expression for GM or mutual conductance. So that's why this can be written like minus GM times RT. Or if I consider the mod of AV, the magnitude is given by GM times RT. Almost a similar expression which we have seen in case of a BJT common emitter amplifier with emitter terminal connected directly to the ground, and we have only one collector resistance RC, and perhaps you can remember the expression for the voltage gain was given by GM times RC. So similar expression we have got for a common stage common source stage amplifier, MOS amplifier. We have found that the expression for the voltage gain is given by GM times RT. So we are happy with this expression that it is fine, but obviously this particular expression is having certain limitation. So first of all, before going into that limitation, let me tell you what happens in the linear region. So that is the expression in the saturation region, that is fine. Expression for the voltage gain in the saturation region. But what happens? What about the V out by V in ratio in the linear region or triode region? So as you understand, in the linear region, the device can be modeled as a simple resistance. So although we have a circuit like this, so an amplifier with a resistance RD and MOS. But in the linear region, so this is VDD, this is RD, and we are taking the output from this terminal. So in the linear region, or if I consider deep triode region, whenever the value of VDS is much, much smaller as compared to the overdrive voltage, so that can be equivalently substituted by, so we have a resistance over here, RD, and we have another resistance R on. So we have VDD over here. This is RD, and the MOS can be modeled by means of a resistance. So let this resistance be represented by R on. And we are taking the output from this terminal, that is V out. So just by observing this particular topology, you can easily find out what is the expression for V out. So simple voltage divider law. So V out is given by R on by RD plus R on into VDD. Now what about R on? So lastly, we have seen that the expression for R on is just the opposite of or reverse of GM or mutual conductance. And we can find that this is given by 1 upon mu n cox W by L . So what we can write is, we can simply write V in In the expression we have VGS, but here VGS equal to Vin. So Vin minus VTH. That was the expression for R on. And accordingly, you can, if I just put this expression over here, you can find out the expression for V out. So this condition is true in linear region. But our emphasis in MOS amplifier design will be there in the saturation region, where the gain value is given by GM times RT. Now let us try to identify what are the difficulty associated with this particular expression. The first difficulty is that we have already computed the expression for GM, and the expression for GM was like GM was found to be mu n C ox W by L into V in minus VTH. That means the expression for gain is not at all constant. So it depends upon, so this AV is a function of the input voltage. So that is very important. We always want that the expression for gain will be constant irrespective of the input value or irrespective of any other parameter, external parameter. But here we find that even if the other parameters are remaining fixed, like the device parameter, device dimension, the CMOS technology and everything, even if the threshold voltage is constant, we find that the expression for the voltage gain is a function of the input voltage. That means if I operate this one, if I operate the MOS as an amplifier, whenever the input voltage is small, that means if I consider over here, when the input voltage is small, then the expression of gain will also be small because GM is small. GM is a direct function of Vin minus VTH. So as Vin increases, the expression for GM, I mean the GM value will also increase. So therefore, whenever we are here, when the input voltage is small, or overdrive voltage is small, so you'll find that the GM value is small, so the gain will be small. On the other hand, if you move over here, but the input voltage is sufficiently large, then it will affect the mutual conductance, and the mutual conductance value will be large, and the gain value will be large. So over a region, if I consider that Vin minus VT, that expression, if I just neglect the corresponding variation, if I consider our notion of small signal, in which case this input voltage is small with respect to the corresponding fluctuation. So in that case, I may consider that GM is constant, but over a large change of the input signal, then the corresponding gain is not at all constant, and it will ultimately lead to the nonlinearity, and which is not at all desirable. So therefore, our objective is to, since the GM is not constant, we find that the GM value is not constant. And in fact, you will find that GM will attain a peak value, and then the corresponding value of, I mean, the gain value will attain a peak, and then ultimately the gain will drop down. So here our objective is to maximize the value of the gain. So to maximize the value of the gain, so let us once again write down the expression for the gain on the peak, I mean, modulus of the gain that is given by GM times RT. And let us try to represent GM in a different manner. So we know that GM can be represented by mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH. And in the saturation region, the drain current is given by half mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. So let us try to represent, let us try to replace this VGS minus VTH in terms of the drain current. So if I do that, so we'll find that this VGS minus VTH, in fact, we have derived that expression in the last day also. So from this expression, we find that it's given by square root of 2ID divided by mu n C ox W by L. So if I put it over here, we find that we have root over, we do have 2ID. And then, okay. it will be like 2 mu n cox w by l. So VGS minus VTH is this much. So 2 mu n cox w by l. And then let us try to separate the other two parameters, that is root IT multiplied with RT. So that can be equivalent to like 2 mu n cox w by l into root ID, and RD can be represented by VRD by ID. What is VRD? VRD is the voltage drop across the resistance RD. If I once again go back, so VRD is the voltage drop across this. So VDD minus VRD is equal to your Vout. So ultimately, this expression can be further simplified too. So I'm keeping that part outside, because for a particular CMOS technology and for a fixed device dimension, the term inside this square root will be constant. And we have VRD upon root ID. So that is the expression for gain. So ultimately, we have represented GM in terms of the individual parameters, like device parameters, W by L, the CMOS technology parameters, COS, the mobility of the electrons, mu n, and the voltage and the current. So we have the voltage expression VRD, the voltage drop across the resistance RD, and the current through the current through this resistance ID. So to increase the AV, so what is our objective? Our objective is to enhance the value of AV or mod AV. So we would like to increase AV, the gain. So what are the options available to us? So one option, suppose obviously mu n is constant, mobility of the electron is constant, that is fine. So if I consider particular device, CMOS technology, so oxide capacitance per unit area, it is also constant. So I cannot control this mu n and cox. I can change the value of W by L. So in that case, the device dimension will be modified, and it might have some adverse effect on the capacitance value, the device capacitance. So it will not be better modify the value of W by L, because ultimately it can adversely affect the transient response of the device or amplifier. So what are the options available to us to increase the gain? So one option is that you can reduce ID or you increase VRD. So option is either you increase VRD or you reduce ID. So if we reduce ID, that means for a particular VDD, if you reduce ID, that means you have to increase the value of the resistance RD. So reducing ID means you have to increase the resistance. And ultimately, if you increase the drain resistance RD, the corresponding time constant in the output side will also increase. And as a matter of fact, it will also affect the corresponding bandwidth of the amplifier. So what option is left with us? We have to increase the VRD. That means the voltage drop across the resistance RT. But you must not forget that this V out is given by VDD minus VRT. So that is the expression for, or in other words, I can write, okay, VDD minus VRT. So if I just once again go back to the previous slide, you'll see that VDD has been divided into two segments. One is the drop across the resistance, that is VRT. So I'm calling this as the VRT. As you can understand, this as VRD, the voltage drop across RD, that is VRD, and we have this Vout component. So VDD has been divided into two different components, VDD, VRD, and Vout. So in order to increase the voltage gain, the only option that seems to be feasible to us is to increase the value of VRD. That means increasing the value of the drop across the resistance RD. But what adverse effect we have to pay for it? The adverse effect is that for a fixed VDD, if the supply voltage is fixed, and if you go on increasing VRD, what happens? The available swing for the output voltage and as well as for the input voltage will be small, because Vout is given by VDD minus VRD. So if I increase, go on increasing VRD, obviously you cannot increase it beyond VDD. But if the value is large, for example, if I consider VDD is equal to 5 volt, and if I make a VRD say close to 4 volt, then what happens? At most, the value, you know, what we have at this particular point, because you know that in the saturation region, the condition is VDS. On the verge of saturation, we have VDS that is equal to V out must be equal to VGS, that is V in, minus VTH. That is on the verge of saturation. And however, the value of V out is already limited by VDD minus VRD. So any attempt which increases the value of VRD will ultimately pose certain limitation on the maximum allowable fluctuation of V out. And in case whenever the value of VDD, that means the supply voltage, is small enough, say I'm considering instead of having a 5 volt supply, if I have a 3 volt supply, so in that case, the situation will be even more difficult to handle, because while considering the different consideration for the MOS amplifier, one observation that we have already made is about the power consumption. Perhaps you know that in case of MOS amplifier, the power consumption resulting from the overall architecture is much, much small. And that's why this is readily used in almost all IC circuits today. And so our objective is to reduce the value of the power consumption. So as you are reducing the device dimension, so initially the device dimension was in the order of few microns, and now we are working in the area of few nanometer. So as the device dimension is go on reducing year after year, so automatically the corresponding supply voltage is no longer constant. So nowadays we can have a supply voltage as small as 1.5 volt, even smaller. So if the supply voltage is small, then what happens? If the VDD is small, then you don't find the enough fluctuation for the output voltage. So lower supply voltage will make the situation even more complicated. So these are the certain limitations. That means this particular circuit with a simple RT, simple externally connected resistance, and a common source stage like this is a good first-hand solution for a MOS amplifier. But obviously, this particular amplifier is having severe disadvantages or severe limitations. And we will be looking upon these limitations one after another while considering this particular unit. But to start with, to understand the notion of a MOS amplifier, how can we use a NMOS device as an amplifier? So that's a very good example to start. Now, in this particular discussion so far, I have not considered the effect of the channel length modulation. But before that, before I discuss anything regarding the channel length modulation, I think it will be the right time to discuss about the small signal model of a MOS device. So already you have seen the small signal model of the bipolar junction transistor in electronic circuits course, where we have the different parameters like the mutual conductance GM, you have this output resistance like RO, and we have RPi. So there are different parameters which can constitute the small signal model of a bipolar junction transistor. So similarly for a MOS device, now we are in a position to draw the small signal model of such an amplifier or such a device. So obviously, so let me just draw the symbol of MOS first. So initially, let us start with three terminals, and later on, I will be adding upon the fourth terminal, that is the second gate or the body terminal or the bulk or substrate. So initially, as you understand that we have a gate terminal, so let us consider the source terminal to be the common terminal over here. So suppose this is the source terminal, S. And gate and source, they are not electrically connected because there is an insulator in between, so they are not electrically connected. So suppose this is the gate terminal, but they are not electrically connected. However, the drain current that flows through the device is a function of the gate to source voltage. And depending on the value of the gate to source voltage, there is a parameter which is called the mutual conductance or transconductance. It will convert the corresponding variation in the gate to source voltage into the drain current. So we have a parameter like VGS, gate to source voltage, and that controls the drain current. and that dependence is readily identified by the mutual conductance or GM. So if this is my drain terminal, then this can be modeled by means of a voltage dependent current source, and that is given by GM VGS. So this is the source terminal, this is the gate terminal, and we have, suppose we can apply a voltage over here across at this particular point, and this is the drain terminal. So this is the simplest model. We have considered only this GM VGS as the voltage dependent current source, and we do have the source terminal over here. Now obviously that can be further modified, because so far we have not considered the effect of the body effect, and neither we have considered the effect of the channel length modulation. So as you understand, the channel length modulation is a particular phenomenon in which case the drain current is also a function of the drain to source voltage. So as you know, whenever I am considering the channel length modulation, so ID value can be represented as half mu n cox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square into 1 plus lambda VDS. So as you find, the ID, the expression for ID, is also dependent upon the value of VDS. So that dependence can be easily calculated by finding out the variation of ID with respect to VDS. So one can easily find out this variation is del ID upon del VDS. So if you compute this one, you will find that here it will be like with respect to VDS, if I differentiate, so we have half mu n cox W by L VGS minus VTH whole square, and then we have a lambda term here. Now that expression, although the expression for ID is given by half mu n cox W by L VGS minus VTH whole square into 1 plus lambda VDS, but if I just neglect that slope, then this expression half to this square can be approximated to ID. So although we are making a certain approximation over here, but ID can be approximated to half mu n cox W by L VGS minus VTH whole square, but the actual value is given by 1 plus lambda VDS. But for the sake of completeness, or for the sake of representing the expression for output resistance, what we can do is we can equate this delta ID by delta VDS with lambda times ID. So therefore, the output resistance RO is given by 1 upon delta ID by delta VDS, that is given by 1 upon lambda ID. So this particular resistance RO or R naught will identify the variation of the output current because of the variation of the drain to source voltage. So therefore, apart from this voltage dependent current source, we do have another resistance for which the value of the resistance, or we do have another, what we can say is we do have another current source, but the value of the current source is dependent upon the value of the potential difference between the two terminals of it. For example, here the current source is being placed between drain to source, and the voltage source that we are taking over here is gate to source voltage. But whenever we would like to find out the variation of the output current with respect to the drain to source voltage, then it will be like some value multiplied with VDS. So here the current source value is dependent upon a voltage source, and the terminal voltages of this voltage source is exactly equal to the two terminals of the current source. So therefore, it can be readily represented by means of a simple resistance. That means if I have a current source like this, suppose we do have two parameters. Suppose let us consider this is node A, this is node B, and we do have a current source over here. And suppose this current source is a function of some alpha into VAB. That means the magnitude of the current source depends upon the voltage source or the voltage difference between the two terminals at which it is connected. So that means it can be simply represented by means of a resistance. And that resistance value over here is nothing but your R naught. So if I consider the effect of channel length modulation, so that can be represented by means of R naught, whose value is given by 1 upon lambda I D. Now apart from that, so far we have neglected the second order effect, and that effect is known as the body effect. So far we have assumed that this VSB is equal to zero. That means source and the bulk, they are connected together. But if they are not connected together, then it might have another dependence on the drain current. So as you know, the threshold voltage is also a function of the source to bulk potential. So we have considered this expression last day. So as long as VSB equal to zero, that means source to body or source to bulk potential, as long as it is zero, so VTH equal to VTH zero. But if not, VSB is not equal to zero, then obviously the body effect will be prominent and you cannot neglect the effect of the body effect. And under this condition, what happens if VSB is non-zero? So for PMOS, VSB will be negative, and for NMOS, VSB will be positive. So for NMOS, this is greater than zero, but however, the mod value is always greater than zero. So VSB is greater than zero for NMOS. That means if the source is connected to ground, the bulk potential should be at some negative value. So we have a p-type substrate. You know, to make this p-n junction reverse bias, so p-type substrate must be connected to the negative potential. So VSB must be greater than zero for NMOS. And under this condition, you will find that VTH value will be greater than VTH. So far, we have assumed that in this expression that, okay, this VTH is constant, but VTH is never constant if we consider the effect of body, or if you consider the impact of body effect. So under this condition, apart from this voltage dependent current source, GMVGS, you do have another parameter, and which is known as the GMBVBS. As you understand, as the VSG value increases, as VSB increases, initially, if I forget about the body effect, then VSB equal to zero. That means source and bulk, they are connected together. But if VSB is non-zero, if it is greater than zero, obviously VTH value will be higher than VTH zero. And if VTH is higher, then for a fixed VGS, a fixed gate to source voltage, the overdrive voltage will be small. For VSB greater than zero, what happens? For a fixed VGS, overdrive voltage, is small, and the corresponding value of ID will also be small. If the overdrive voltage is small and the ID, the drain current depends upon the overdrive voltage. So if the overdrive voltage is small because of the higher value of VTH, so obviously the ID value, that means the drain current, will be also small. So increasing VSB will reduce the ID, or in other words, we can say that increasing VSB means reducing VBS. So reducing VBS will reduce the ID, or in other words, increasing VBS, we can have an increasing value of the drain current. So therefore, we can insert the third element to take into account the effect of, or the impact of, the body effect. So another current source. So I request mute. You can mute yourself. Otherwise, it is creating noise. Okay, so let me come back. So it will be GMB VBS. So as you can see, increasing VSB will have the effect of reducing ID. Therefore, reducing VBS will be having the effect of reducing ID. So apart from this GMB VBS, we do have another parameter, that is GMB VBS. So we need to find out the expression for this VBS. So how to find it out? So in order to find out the expression, GMB, which is nothing but the variation of ID with respect to the VBS. VBS is given by bulk to source potential. So let me write down the expression first for ID. That is given by half mu n cox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. So the effect of VBS is reflected in VTH only, because whenever I am changing the value of VBS, the source to bulk potential, then the value of VTH will be modified according to this equation. So therefore, del ID by del VBS will be reflected as, so you have a minus sign over here, and then we have mu n c ox W by L into VGS minus VTH, and then del VTH by del VBS. Yeah, del VTH by del VBS. So as you understand that del VTH by del VBS is given by minus of del VTH by del VSB. So if I take this minus together, so ultimately you have mu n c ox W by L VGS minus VTH into del VTH by del VSB. So I have to calculate the expression for this del VTH by del VSB. So from this expression itself, what I can find is del VTH by del VSB is given by, so this is constant, then you have a gamma over here, the coefficient of body effect, and then we have, done a mistake over here, it will be twice pi f only. You should point it out before. will be twice pi f. So in the expression, right, it will be root over of twice pi a plus Vsb minus square root of twice pi a. In case Vsb equal to zero, then this entire expression inside the bracket will become zero. But in case Vsb is greater than zero, then the expression within the bracket will be positive and Vth will be higher than Vth. So this is a change we have to make it. So if I just find out the expression of del Vth by del Vsb, and then you will find that it is like gamma, that is the coefficient, and you have half over here, root to the power half, so half and half minus one, that is minus half, so one upon root over of twice phi f plus Vsb. So if I put this over here, then ultimately this del id by del Vs, what we find here is Gm B, that is the mutual conductance considering the body effect, is given by del ID upon del VBS, is given by mu n C aux W by L VGS minus VTH, so that old expression, multiplied with del Vth by del Vsb, and that value is given by gamma by this one. So we have a gamma by 2 twice phi f plus Vsb. So the expression for Gmb ultimately reduces to, so this one is Gm mu n C aux W by L Vgs minus Vth multiplied with gamma by 2 square root of twice phi f plus Vsb. And sometimes it is written as eta times Gm. It's a function of Gm itself. And eta depends upon the gamma, the corresponding coefficient of the body effect. And as Vsb increases, the corresponding value of Gmb drops down. What does it mean physically? Mathematically, you can see that as Vsb increases, that means the body effect is becoming much more prominent. And at the same time, the corresponding value of Gmb drops down. What does it mean physically? As Vsb increases, the corresponding value of the threshold voltage will be much larger. So therefore, the overdrive voltage for a fixed value of the gate to source voltage, the overdrive voltage will be small. And since overdrive voltage is small, therefore the corresponding change in the drain current will also be small, and Gmb is that particular parameter which is responsible for converting the effect of or the impact of the body effect into the drain current. So by means of this expression, you can find out the third element of the small signal model. So ultimately we do have three different parameters. So I think it will be better if I just so I need to show the effect of, so this is source, and this terminal is, suppose this is the bulk terminal, and this potential is VBS. So VBS is the potential difference between the bulk and the source, VB minus VS. So we have identified three different parameters in the small signal model. One is the Gm value, that is the mutual conductance, whose expression is given by mu n C aux W by L into Vgs minus Vth in saturation region. And the value of R naught, that is the output resistance, given by 1 upon lambda ID, which is responsible for reflecting the effect of channel length modulation. And the third one is the body effect. And the body effect has been identified by means of another voltage dependent current source, that is Gmb VBS. Now with these three different elements, so the design of the small signal model of MOS amplifier is complete. Now let me go back where I have left. Small signal amplifier. Now so far we have not considered the effect of the channel length modulation in this particular discussion. So even if you consider this expression, we have seen that the output, I mean the drain current, has been represented by mu n C aux W by L into V in minus VTH whole square only. So we have not considered so far the effect of the channel length modulation. But however, if you're perfect, then you have to consider the effect of the channel length modulation, and accordingly we have to once again recalculate the expression for the voltage gain. So the diagram, I mean the circuit diagram being the same, so there is no change in the circuit diagram, but we have to consider the effect. So this one is RD, this is VDD, this is V out, and this one is V in. So the expression for V out is given by VDD minus IDRD. And in the saturation region, so far we have neglected the effect of the VDS, but now we cannot neglect. So let me incorporate this one, half mu n C aux W by L. So here we have V in minus VTH whole square multiplied with 1 plus lambda V out. So it is basically 1 plus lambda VDS. Now here VDS is nothing but the V out, because drain potential equal to V out and the source potential is at ground. So VDS equal to V out. Now with this expression, let us try to find out the del V out by del V in. So del V out by del V in is given by, so the first term will be zero. Then we have half, so it will be minus first. Mu n C aux W by L then we have V in minus VTH into 1 plus lambda V out. And then the second term, like half mu n C aux W by L. So I'm considering the UV, the product law of differentiation. So half mu n C aux W by L, so this is constant always. So we have two parameters, V in minus VTH whole square and 1 plus lambda V out. So these two variables are there, and which are dependent upon V in. So keeping this 1 plus lambda V out constant, I have just differentiated this part with respect to V in. So we have 2 here, so 2 and half gets cancelled, and V in minus VTH x square will become x. And that is 1, fine. So 1 plus lambda V out, and then the second term, keeping this V in minus VTH square constant, so half mu n C aux W by L, and then we have V in minus VTH whole square and 1 plus lambda V out. So 1 will become 0 if I differentiate it with respect to V in, and then we have lambda times AV. So lambda times AV. So ultimately, del V out by del V in, that is expression for AV, is given by, so this expression, mu n C aux W by L into V in minus VTH into 1 plus lambda V out. And obviously, perhaps I have missed one part, that is the RD. So the resistance part I have missed. So it will be better if I put RD over here, or so RD will be there. So the entire expression will be multiplied by RD. So ultimately, the AV expression, I mean the gain of the amplifier, is given by, so the first term, this minus mu n C aux W by L into V in minus VTH into 1 plus lambda V out, is nothing but the expression for the mutual conductance considering the effect of the channel length modulation. So we have like minus gm times rd, as we have already got, and then we have the second part, and this can be equated to id, this half mu n c of w by l v in minus vth whole square. Can be approximated, but we have just neglected this 1 plus lambda vds term, 1 plus lambda v out term. So that can be approximated to id. So under this condition, if it is approximated to id, then ultimately we have like lambda id av rd. And if I take av in one side, so 1 plus lambda id rd, 1 plus lambda id rd is equal to minus gm times rd. So from that one can easily find out the expression for the voltage gain, that is given by minus gm times rd divided by 1 plus lambda id into rd. Now already we have seen that this lambda id is the expression for 1 upon ro. So we have already seen this expression, that ro is given by 1 upon lambda id, the output resistance, and that is resulting from the channel length modulation. So that substitution we can easily do over here. So we can easily put this value like minus gm times rd, and we have 1 plus rd by ro. So ultimately what we have is minus gm ro divided by ro plus rd into rd. So that is the ultimate expression. We can further simplify that expression. So apart from the gm rd, so last time we have seen that the corresponding value of the voltage gain, it was like the mod value of that, the modulus of the voltage gain was given by gm times rd. And this time, apart from this rd, we have this r naught and rd. So ultimately, if I just go to the next slide, then we can show you that ultimately the expression of voltage gain, the mod of this, it was the last slide, it was like gm r naught rd by r naught plus rd. That means we have gm and then we have the parallel combination of r naught and rd. Now if r naught is large with respect to rd, that can be approximated to gm times rd. But if you are perfect enough, and if you would like to find out the accurate expression for the voltage gain, then the accurate expression is given by gm r naught parallel rd. Now the same thing can also be done. So here we have considered the expression of the voltages and current, and we have found out this del V out by del V in to ultimately get the solution. So instead of considering this mathematical equation, what we can do is we can also come to the same expression for the voltage gain just by looking at the small signal model. So for this, first of all, let me draw the circuit and the corresponding small signal model. So this was the circuit, V out, this was VDD, we have RD over here, and we have V in. And what about the corresponding small signal model? Now, first of all, you need to draw the small signal model pertaining to the device, pertaining to the MOS amplifier. So we have the gate terminal and the voltage applied is V in, the input voltage. So this is the gate terminal, Now let us assume that the body effect is not pronounced. So this is source. The source terminal, and this is a drain terminal. So we have GM times V in, GM VGS, and the other parameter, that is RO, resulting from the channel length modulation, since we have considered the effect of channel length over here. So R naught must be there, which is connected between this drain and source. And apart from that, we do have this resistance RD. So RD has to be connected. So if you would like to find out the expression for the voltage gain, you'll see that this R naught and RD, they are coming in shunt. So therefore, the corresponding equivalent resistance is given by R naught parallel RD. And the current that is flowing over here is GM times Vin. So GM times Vin is the current that is flowing. And it is flowing through the resistance R naught parallel RD. So whatever would be the voltage developed over here at this particular point at the drain terminal, the voltage is given by GM into Vin into R naught parallel RD, and that is equal to your output voltage. So from that you can easily calculate the voltage gain is given by GM into R naught parallel RD. However, as far as the polarity of the output voltage is concerned, here you will find that the output voltage will be negative, because as far as the direction of the current is concerned over here, so you'll find that this potential is at a negative point with respect to the source. So that's why a minus sign is coming outside. But if I just consider the modulus, the magnitude of the voltage gain, so magnitude of the voltage gain is given by GM times R naught parallel RT. So the same thing can also be done using a small signal model, and we have also arrived at the same expression just by considering the equation of the particular MOS amplifier. So with this, I would like to conclude this introductory lecture on the MOS amplifier, and we have several other aspects of the MOS amplifier to consider. So today I have considered a simple, in fact the simplest MOS amplifier in common source configuration involving an external resistance like RT. But in fact you'll see that, in fact in the next class I'll be discussing about how to implement this resistance by means of the MOS itself. And we have considered the effect of the channel and modulation in finding out the expression for the gain. So in fact we have considered two different gain expression, one for considering the channel and modulation and the second one without considering the effect of the channel and modulation. And ultimately we have also derived the small signal model, and which will be beneficial in finding out or in analyzing the circuit whenever the circuit is even more complex, not a simpler one like this. So with this, let me conclude today's discussion on the MOS amplifier.